Hi again, everyone. Chris Tisdell here again. In this presentation, I'm going to show you a somewhat new proof for the famous formula of Euler. Now, let me share my my screen with you. So here is the famous formula named after the mathematician Euler. And essentially, it relates the exponential with cosine, sine, and I. Here, I is the imaginary unit seen in, say, a course in complex numbers, and it satisfies I squared equals negative 1. Now, this famous formula has been around for hundreds of years, and it was first proved by Euler in the 1740s using power series. So you write the cosine as a power series, sine as a power series, the exponential as a power series, and then you equate real and imaginary parts. Now, in this presentation, I'm going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to use an approach that is related to differential equations, and it's based on the fact that solutions to certain initial value problems involving ordinary differential equations, the solutions are unique. Okay, now there are a few different ways to prove this identity. Euler did the power series method, and in fact there's a Khan Academy video about that as well. There's also a limit way to prove it, which you'll find on Wikipedia. And there's also a way that Gil Strang does it using calculus assuming that this can be written in the R cis theta form. Okay, I'm not going to do any of those. Okay, so how do I actually do it? Well, let me show you. And one of the nice things about this, that the method I'm going to show you, is that you can prove all sorts of other identities with this method just by using some basic differential equations. So let me show you how it works. Okay. Now, I should add before I start that the proof for this result, it's kind of motivated by a mathematician called Richard Bellman. Okay, so certainly the proof I'm going to show you would be known, but you just don't see it very many places. Okay, all right. So I'm going to let, say, a function be this e to the ix. I'm going to differentiate this function and see what differential equation f satisfies. Okay. All right, so if I differentiate just by treating I as a constant, bring the I to the front. And if I differentiate again, okay, so I will come to the front, and we know I squared equals negative 1. So I'll get the following. Okay, so you notice that f double dash is the negative of f. So now I've got a differential equation. Okay. Okay, so here is our differential equation that our f satisfies. Okay, so I'm going to now build some, or construct some, initial values to go with our second order differential equation. So let me show you how we do that. Okay, so if we go up here and I plug in, say, x equals 0, I'll get e to the 0, which is 0. Oh, sorry, e to the 0, which is 1. And if I go up here and plug in x equals 0, I'll get I times e to the 0, which is just I. Okay, so now we have an initial value problem. Okay, in particular, this is a linear second order problem with constant coefficients, and we have some initial conditions associated with it. Okay. This IVP, or initial value problem, has a unique solution. And that's, you would learn that, say, in a first course in ordinary differential equations. Now, because the coefficients are constant in this problem, it's actually easy to solve this problem for F. Now I'm just going to write this down as G, and you'll see why I've done that in a minute. Okay, so you can look at the characteristic equation, characteristic equation will be something like R squared plus 1 equals 0, and so the roots will be complex. Okay, and you can write the general solution to this problem as a linear combination of cosines and sines, where the A and B, because of the initial conditions, could be complex numbers. Okay, and in particular, if you go and calculate the A and B, you'll get the following. Okay, if you say put in x equals 0 and set it equal to 1, differentiate, set x equals 0, and equate it with I, then you'll get these two values for A and B. Okay, so if I go up to here and plug in A equals 1 and B equals I, I'll get the following. Okay. All right. So what now? We've shown that e to the ix satisfies a certain initial value problem, and then we've taken that initial value problem and we've solved it. Now, because the initial value problem under consideration is a special initial value problem, it has special properties. Because of the uniqueness, there's one and only one solution to that problem. The two functions that we've started with or derived here, the f and the g, must be equal. Okay, so let me show you how that works. Let me share my screen again. Okay, so by uniqueness of solutions to our IVP, or our initial value problem, this and this must be the same. So F must be identically equal to G. That's what these sort of three horizontal lines mean. That is, e to the ix must equal cosine x plus I sine x. Okay, and we've finished our proof. Okay. All right, so there are some advantages and disadvantages of this proof. Okay, firstly, you need to know a little bit about differential equations to really appreciate the style of proof that I've mentioned. One of the positives, as far as I can see, for the method of proof that I've just shown you, is that it gives you a nice way of applying the idea of uniqueness of solutions to differential equations and initial value problems. Okay, you can use the theory of differential equations to prove all sorts of nice formulae or identities if you like. Okay, now is this as simple as, say, Euler's method using power series? Well, no. Okay, no. But I still think it's really nice to talk about this proof because I haven't seen it anywhere. It's not on. I don't think it's on YouTube. I have seen a first order type approach to prove this identity, but I've never seen a second order approach. Okay, so I think I'm sort of adding something new there. All right. Now, if you get a chance, see what other identities you can prove, say involving trig functions using differential equations. There's a whole bunch of them that you can prove, and it provides a nice alternative to say a geometric approach. Now, if you have any comments or questions, suggestions or criticisms, I'd love to hear them. Please post comments. I'm always trying to improve what I do, especially with this new Google Plus live class approach. As you can see, the camera's moving a little bit because I've set it to follow my face. Let me know what you think of that. Is that annoying? If it's annoying, I'll change it. Okay. So yeah, your comments are all valued. So let me know what you think, and I'll see you for more Hangouts and live math classes in the future. Thanks for watching.